Hi, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to introduce a music legend. This is Ron Griffiths, part two interview with Plastic EP, Daniel Costin and Mr. Shampoo. And let me tell you, I meet a lot of celebrities and I meet a lot of people and I talk to them about music. But when I talk to Ron and I talk about the Ivies and I talk about Badfinger, you know how genuine he is and what a great musician. I've gone back and looked at his film clips. And I personally salute you, Ron. I want you to know that because you know what? In music history, you stand out. And I'm so, it's to me, it's such a privilege to even talk to you today.
Well, all I can say is thanks for that wonderful introduction. I'm as flattered as I was last time. Maybe tomorrow you will love again. I'll never know.
That's good. Now, what I want to do is let's go back. And the first person to record the Ivies was Ray Davies from the Kinks. So tell me about that and the Kinks.
Well, how that came about, I don't know how we ended up taking him up. We met a man named Dave Duffield. He was the Kinks road manager, stroke tour manager, they call him these days. We needed assistance in paying the rent on the house we had at Golders Green. So he came on board and helped with the rent because the Mojos had moved out. They were in there before we ever moved up there. During the course of the stay that when Dave joined us, we got to know him. He was a lovely lad. He used to listen to our material that we'd recorded in the demo studio that we had. And obviously, he was very involved with the Kinks. He actually had a word with Ray Davies and said, these lads I'm living with, you want to come and have a listen to some of their material? There's some nice songs that they've composed on demo on a Revox tape recorder. So he came round, had a listen, and was so impressed, he actually took four demo tapes away and arranged for us to record these four tracks in a little studio down on the old Kent Road. I cannot remember the name of the studio, but we couldn't get over the sound we made when we got, well, it was the first time we'd actually had a proper recording session anywhere. And it wasn't a big name studio like, you know, the likes of EMI or any of those. When they played the stuff back that we'd recorded over the studio monitors, we couldn't believe it was us because of the powerful sound that came out the speakers. Because all we were used to was hearing these songs on a little two-track Revox tape recorder. So we were blown away. That's how we became involved with Ray Davies. What was another thing they did in these recording studios, which blew me away, they had the ability to be able to cut the sound from these great big monitors, which would come out of a hi-fi system or a jukebox, and they'd flick a switch, and it came out into a little speaker like that, that sort of thing you'd get in a transistor radio to see that the balance was spot on.
Yeah, that's amazing. A song you really got me. That's where they reckon Dave used a little amp, as I said, and cut the speaker with a little razor blade in his tiny amp, and you got sound.
To get that rough sound, yeah. I read that somewhere.
Ron, great to talk to you again. How was Ray to work with as a producer? Because a lot of the Kinks fans will know that he ended up producing a number of things, including the Turtles' Turtle Soup album. How'd you find him to work with as a producer?
Well, he was a nice down-to-earth fella. You know, he was a North Londoner from Muswell Hill, and he wasn't full of airs and graces. He was very, very, very easy to get on with. That's all I can say, really. Those are the only four tracks he recorded with us. I can't remember them all. One was called I Believe in You Girl. The other one was called Taxi. I can't remember the other two, and that's terrible, isn't it?
I heard that you were at Trident Studios with Mike Gibbons, and Paul took you over into the studio and said, look, here's our new song. And you and Mike heard it for the first time. Now, I'm not going to tell you what the song is, and you can tell them what that song was.
Yeah, that was one of life's memorable moments. Yeah, well, we'd gone down to do an all-night recording session, overdubs and stuff like that. I don't think we took everything with us. It was just to add little bits onto something we'd already recorded. Mike Gibbons and myself were sitting on the studio floor having a coffee. And in those days, I used to smoke, so I had a cigarette on the go as well as Mike. And Paul McCartney came down from the control room. He'd been listening to what we'd done. I think the song was called Mrs. Jones, if my memory serves me well. And he said, "Oh, I like that one, lads. Very, very nice song you got going on up there. Have a listen to this. This might be our next recording, our next single." So he sat behind the Steinway piano, which was on the studio. Mike and I got up off the floor and parked our coffees. And in the well of the grand piano, we're standing there leaning on it, watching him. And he launched into Hey Jude, just as if he was performing it on a gig. And nobody else in the world had heard it at that time, except for Mike Gibbons and me, unless he played it to the Beatles themselves. But we were standing there gobsmacked, sort of looking at each other. Is this happening to us? This can't be right, you know. We had no mobile phones or cameras on us in those days, so obviously it's all up here. There's no evidence of it. But he actually played Hey Jude to us personally to say this is going to be our next single. What an experience.
Well, that was great. And my next question, Ron, is that fact that it is you on Come and Get It, even though it doesn't show you on videos. It is you being wet bass, and
I just love your
bass style. And I heard that you were a great Shadows fan, and I just love Jet Harris. I mean, he was cool, and he played that big Fender bass, and that's what you had stolen.
That's right. Well, he was a major influence at the start, in all fairness, you know. I always liked the sound of bass and percussion in general because my dad used to have a good radiogram and the bass used to leap out.
That's right.
And I always liked it, and I'm a natural harmonizer anyway. And I've got, if I wasn't a bass player, I'd probably be a drummer. I've got all the patterns in my head. That's amazing to know that you're a big Shadows fan. He was great. He was very innovative. He's a very, very good musician and underrated, Jet Harris.
Absolutely. And on Come and Get It, there's a tape floating around on YouTube, and it's Paul McCartney in the studio producing you guys. And he says to you, he says, "Okay, Ron, I'm going to have you go singing at the lead." And you actually tried singing that song.
Well, we all had a shot at it. Peter Ham had a go. So did I. He thought Peter Ham's voice wasn't sharp enough or didn't have enough cut. So I overdid it, and he told me I sounded like Reg Plesley out of Drugs.
If you want it, here it is, come and get it. Make your mind up fast. If you want it anytime, I can give it. But you better hurry, 'cause it may not last. Did I hear you say that there must be a catch? Will you walk away from a fool and his money? If you want it, here it is, come and get it. Hurry, 'cause it's going fast.
We'll let you know, Ron.
Well, you know, in the end, what Paul did was they slowed down the version down from E to E flat. So people don't, I didn't even know it was slowed down, but I play bass myself, and I've watched you in quite a few videos, and your bass technique was way ahead of its time. I mean, hitting a harmonic while you're playing, I mean, that was just innovative, Ron. Thanks for that.
Tony Visconti commentated on that. It was just a case of, I don't know, it was accidental, because although slap bass wasn't in fashion in those days, I used to pin the string against the fret and it did create a harmonic. And Tony Visconti loved that for some reason or other. But the most incisive thing I did on Come and Get It, when Paul McCartney gave us the demo, he asked us to play it exactly as we heard it. So for the first 7 or 8 or 9 takes, I was just finishing it like he did. Dum. And eventually, a little later on in the recording, I actually thought, I'm going to do a runoff at the end of this. So you've obviously heard it. It's where it tails off and goes boom, 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 at the end of the song. And Paul McCartney shouts, you know, they cut the tape. Hey, Ron, that was great, man. We'll keep that one, son. I like that. But there again, there's no evidence of that either. But, you know, I mean, talk about having a feather in your cap. I was absolutely sort of,
Now, Ron, I got to ask you about Dear Angie, okay? To me, it's just a fantastic, great song that you wrote. And I really want to find out the story, how you got the inspiration for that, how you recorded it. Like, give me the full story of that particular song.
I had a girlfriend back then named Maureen Angela Atkinson. And eventually I married her. She became my wife. But she'd come down to Gowler's Green to visit us, or I'd meet her in the West End of London. I'd see her off at Euston Station because she lived 25 miles north of London. And I'd gone back, and I used to have a bash at composing tunes in that studio myself at night. Not all of it was all that good. Some of it was a little bit innovative, I suppose. But I had this idea for a song called, you know, dedicated to her. So I bashed out this chord pattern, and that's where Dear Angie came from. The Angie part is because her name was Angela, and I couldn't say Dear Angela or Dear Maureen, so I cut it down to Dear Angie. That's how the song came about.
Dear Angie, just these lines to confirm something you may know. Train today, you took my heart and soul away. I can't wait till Friday night to see you touch, you hold you tight.
Dear Angie! What a great song. Now, I just want to ask you, with the Ivies, which song do you particularly say, that's me as Ron Griffiths in the Ivies? All right, is there a particular song? And I know you wrote that one, but is there a song out of all of them, because you may have written others, I'm not sure which ones you've written, but is there one particular song when you look back in your career with the Ivies and say, that's me, Ron Griffiths, I put my stamp on that, that is me musically? Which one is it?
Oh, crumbs, that's a difficult one. Well, the only one on those first two albums that I sing anything other than a ballad is called Sally Blue, and I get the lead vocals on that, I suppose. That's a bit more like I would have sounded on a gig. That's about it, really. Apart from putting my stamp on Come and Get It and pinching the end section that Paul McCartney didn't think to do.
I want to backtrack a bit to a story that you discussed with me and Mr. Plastic the last time we talked. I'm a fan of the Kinks' Dead End Street video. And the coffin is very prominent in that video, which was banned by, I believe, by the BBC. I think you might know something about that coffin.
Oh yeah, we have it in the house. Because Dave Duffield was their road manager, all the Kinks gear used to be stashed in our front hallway. I'd actually had a bash on Dave Davis's Gibson Flying V, you know, the V-shaped guitar. Mm-hmm. But the coffin was stashed there either prior to or just after they did the video. And one night what we did for a laugh, we went down to a Wimpy bar down in Golders Green, which is about, I don't know, a quarter mile walk away. We got it so far down, and then we put Mike Gibbons into the coffin and walked into the Wimpy bar holding this coffin, put it on the floor, lifted the lid, and Mike got out. So you can imagine the reaction of the people that were having their supper in there. That was funny. But that's the story of the coffin at Boulder's Green.
Were you there, Ron, when they filmed their video clip?
We were actually invited to go and watch it.
Describe that to me.
Well, it took place over at in Muswell Hill, which is where they were actually from, Dave and Ray. I can't explain anything other than we were driven over there and we just stood behind the cameras and watched it all going on. It was interesting to watch. You know, it took several takes. But we went for a drink afterwards in a pub nearby and had a bit of a chit-chat with them and then went back to the house.
Did you like the song they did, Dead End Street?
Oh, yeah. It's another typical Ray Davies composition, let's face it. He came up with some fantastic stuff. You know, particularly that Village Green Preservation Society album, that's something else.
Can I ask you, did the Ivies ever take the mickey out of Ray? Did they ever go, girl, we really got you now? Did you ever do anything funny musically with him?
No, we did. We actually did a cover of that before we ever came up to London. We used to do that in a couple of other Kinks tunes, which is what you did back in those days. If you went and did gigs at a dance hall, nobody wanted to hear your material. They wanted to hear the songs that were in the charts at the time. So we used to do a few of the Kinks.
We were discussing different tours recently, and I know you did a tour, I believe, with Gene Pitney and Marmalade. Talk a little bit about that tour, because that's, I mean, the entire bill on that, including you guys, is just amazing. And this was, package tours is something that's kind of lost now for a lot of people, but they, you know, you could see all these amazing bands in one night.
Well, they don't seem to do that much these days. There are 60s revival shows that take place over here with some of the original bands are still in place, but most of them are covers and tribute bands now. But we were invited onto that tour principally to promote Coming Maybe Tomorrow. Apple managed to get us on there. I mean, the full band, you had the Mike Cotton band with a house band that backed Gene Pitney and did a set on their own. And Joe Cocker and the Grease Band were also on that tour. It was a great experience, actually. We had suits made for that. I say suits. They were metallic bomber jackets, bolero style jackets. And the purpose was that when we were on stage, all the lamps, the lights that were on us would make these things shimmer and dazzle. We weren't allowed to wear them. We paid to have them made specially, you know, bespoke outfits. And they said, no, you'll be upstaging all the main acts by having these flash jackets on, which was ridiculous, really. So we had to wear somber suits. The suits you can see on the back of, they're on the Maybe Tomorrow, on the one of the albums, you can see the pictures of the suits and the ties we had on. We had to wear them on the actual shows. It was a disappointment, that, actually. We thought we'd really cut a dash for wearing those things. But the actual experience of the tour itself was great. You know, we got pretty chatty with all of them. We'd actually got involved with Marmalade before they were on that tour because we used to do gigs at the Marquee Club in London. And they invited us as guests. This was before they were famous. They used to have a residency at the Marquee. I can't remember how we got to know. I think it was via Junior Campbell, actually. And we got to do support gigs for them down there. So we knew them before we went on that tour.
You know, I got my hands on a very rare album. I'm not sure if you recall it, but it was the Ivies Christmas album. Do you remember it?
Well, it wasn't an album. It was just a Mickey take. I think we did a below the belt version of the 12 Days of Christmas.
Right, that's right. And, you know,
it wasn't very politically correct, but it made people laugh.
There was a picture of Christmas at the studios, and here you are beside Ringo Starr. Do you remember that day?
Yeah, that was Apple's Christmas party.
That's right.
Well, you know what parties like. I mean, there's a lot of wine and champagne and stuff flowing there. I'd gone down just to join in, and we were all in there. We were all having a laugh. I ended up sitting next to Ringo having a chat about nothing in particular. And there was a voice behind us shouting out, "Oi, you too." So of course, I turned around and it was Mal Evans and he took that picture.
Right.
And there's a carrier bag I'm holding in that picture. I had two or three albums in it that I was allowed to, I think I had James Taylor's first album in there and a couple of others. I forget which ones. But yeah, that's how that came about. It's funny, somebody sent me a picture of that the other day on my phone.
Well, it's Mal Evans that discovered the Ivy.
Mal Evans took that snap, yeah.
Yeah, he discovered the Ivies and brought you to Apple. Isn't that true?
Well, he knew Mal Mal knew Bill, the manager, from the Liverpool days because they're both Liverpool lads. And Bill bumped into him. I forget where he was. I don't know whether it was in a music publisher's office or somewhere like that, or they bumped into each other in the street. Whichever way it happened, they bumped into each other. And once they'd exchanged all the pleasantries, Bill casually mentioned that, you want to pop up and see how the band I've got involved with? He said, they've done some original material I think you might be interested in to have a listen. As a matter of fact, we're playing at the Marquee Club tonight. Do you want to come down and have a watch? So he did. He came down and watched the gig. And we used to have our own little spot there. There was one night in the week where they had up-and-coming bands, for want of an expression, a better expression. They didn't actually have name bands on every night. And we got quite a little following down there, and he came down and watched us, and he thoroughly enjoyed it. He thought it reminded him of the Cavern days when the Beatles used to give all this chat to the crowd rather than just stick from one song to another. We used to have a laugh with the crowd. And he came back to Gola's Green with us, and we had a beer or two, and he had to listen to the stuff that we'd got currently on the Revox, and was so impressed he asked Bill to knock a little tape together, and he took it down to Apple and played it to them down there, and that's how we became signed to Apple, just by virtue of Mal watching and taking this tape down there. So we were in the right, Bill was in the right place at the right time, as were we, I guess.
I got to ask you, once you were signed to Apple and you met everyone down there, you're going through the process and you want to record your songs and you're playing demos, the road that you took with Apple, out of everybody there that tried to help you, and even after you had that newspaper interview and Paul wanted to then step forward and give you a song, I mean, in reality, you know what comes across to me? That you were always pushing the Ivies and that you always had an opinion. And you weren't shy to express your opinion. And that's why you guys moved forward, because you basically said, listen, I'm not too happy. I need this done, or I can do better, or I can do that. And I love the cheek. Like, you know, Paul says, play it note for note. And then you just go, right, I'm just going to do a run, see what happens. It's like that bravado that you got that makes your story so unique. You'd agree with that?
Yeah, to a point. I think that was pure chance. I mean, because I was talking to somebody, I didn't know who these people were that did that interview. I didn't even think that they'd print it, to be honest. But I didn't say it with the thing, I mustn't say this. I just spoke as I found. You know, we were all of the same mind, actually, because once we'd got Maybe Tomorrow behind us, and it didn't take off in the UK. It did pretty well on the continent and Japan, and I don't know whether you know this, it got to number 49 or thereabouts in the Cashbox top 100 in the States. We didn't get the airplay it needed over here, I suppose. But on the strength of that, we were all feeling a little bit nonplussed, and they don't seem to like much of what we're doing. So consequently, I was bound to say, we don't get much out of the Beatles, we feel neglected. And it worked. Well, it paid the dividend, didn't it? You know, we ended up with that song.
What were some of your favorite places to play around England?
Well, we did the Cavern quite a lot of times when we went up north. Because we were on limited income, we used to stay at Bill Collins had a council house up in Birkenhead on the other side of the Mersey. Mm-hmm. And he kept the rent up on that all his life. And we used to stay there when we went up north. But we managed to do an audition at the Cavern. That was quite funny because the Cavern was so notorious. They were bringing bands in from here, there and everywhere to have a chance to play on the stage the Beatles played at. So we went up there and joined the queue of bands that were going to do a couple of tunes. And they invited us back. We must have done a dozen gigs there, I would imagine. I can't remember the exact number, but we played there quite regularly. Other gigs, apart from the marquee, we did the 100 Club in Oxford Street. That's another notorious gig. We did the Flamingo, which is in the lower part of Wardour Street. And that was where the likes of Zoot Money and Georgie Fame and all those acts used to play. And we did an all-nighter down there once, and we actually went in there with our gear. And we've never done a gig in a venue so where so many black faces were there. And it was a little bit intimidating, but they loved us. We were doing R&B covers and, you know, up-to-the-minute soul stuff, and they thought we were fantastic. I'm trying to think of other places that were... we did... George Harrison used to own a club called Sibylla's. It was in a back street off Regent Street. I can't remember the name of the music it was in. We played there as well. But most of the other venues were, you know, just nondescript. When we did the Pitney tour, we were playing at most of the venues were theatres, come cinemas converted into theatres. You know, a lot of cinemas were able to take the screen away and you had curtains and a stage. But those are the most famous venues that we played at.
Ron, what was it like to go to Apple and see that huge mural painted on that building and be in there with all those artists like James Taylor and everybody and Derek Taylor and all those things that were happening at Apple?
That was it was just a good experience. We just felt ever so lucky that they'd taken us on board. You know, I would imagine it would have been every unknown band's idea of Nirvana getting signed to Apple. Because the whole purpose of they set that up so they could take on lesser known acts and let them flourish and do their own thing. I think that was the general consensus. That's why they set Apple up. And yes, going in there, when we first started going down there, the only person that we met that had any notoriety at all was Mary Hopkin. And she actually came from 6 or 7 miles up the Swansea Valley where we come from. She was born and brought up in a place called Pontydewy. And when she actually met us, she couldn't get over the fact that three of us at that time had Swansea accents. You know, she was blown away. She couldn't get over the fact that she thought she was on her own, a little Welsh girl, and there were three Welsh lads along with Tommy signed to Apple. James Taylor hadn't signed to them at that time. We'd gone down there one day to, I've no idea, we used to go in there regularly to fraternise and just be there because they have the studio down in the basement. And this particular day we walked in, I was chatting to Pete and I walked into the front door and I didn't see him. James Taylor was sitting in the front entrance porch with his back against the wall and his legs sticking out, and I tripped over his legs. I didn't know who he was. He was just about to sign to Apple, I believe, but he apologized for being in the way and said, "Oh, hi, my name's James. I'm hoping to sign up with these people." That was before he was famous, so we didn't even know who he was, but we certainly did eventually.
Tell me, actually, let's talk a little bit about the Apple Studio in the basement. What were your impressions of that, and how often did you guys work down there?
We tended to rehearse down there. We were actually down there rehearsing the day of the infamous concert up on the roof. The only thing I ever did down there, we had some, there was a book came out during the 60s called Swinging London or something like that. And we were asked to do a recording for it. The book was called Permissive Paradise, I think, or the song was. They gave us this song called Permissive Paradise and asked us if we'd record it. We recorded that down there and, I'm trying to think. It was put on a flexi disc and it was put inside the book as a little gift. I think they renamed us the Pleasure Garden. We didn't have our name on it, and we were paid a fee for it. I've got a copy of that somewhere. I think it's on. I'm pretty sure it's on YouTube somewhere. But the song was called Permissive Paradise, and the Pleasure Garden. The other notable thing I remember about Apple Studios, I was down there on one day on my own. And I was in the control room. They were mixing down this unbelievable sound coming out of the speakers there. It was only Led Zeppelin's first album. I was hearing that before it was released as well.
Now, that's unbelievable, Ron. I've got to ask you now, the day of the concert on the rooftop, were you rehearsing down in the basement while that was going on?
We didn't know about it until somebody came belting down the, I don't know who it was, somebody came shooting down the stairs and interrupted us and said, quick, the boys are up on the roof doing a gig. But we were alerted to it. We switched everything off, put everything down, and it's five flights of stairs. By the time we got up there, the police had stopped it. And we weren't allowed to venture onto the roof. The police stopped us and pushed us back. So we missed the whole thing. Otherwise, we would have been up there watching it.
Thanks so much, Ron, for being with us today. It's been a fantastic interview. Ron Griffiths, part two. We salute you. And as I said, everyone go out there, keep listening to the great music that's out there. And we really appreciate your time, Ron.
Okay, well, it's been a pleasure to chat to you. Thanks very much.
Pleasure.
And everybody, and thank you very much, Nathan. And thank you very much, Dan.